It's time for the Flagler Radio Business Report, a 30-minute roundtable discussion with the local businesses. And now, your host, Kirk Keller.
Good morning and welcome to the Business Report. I'm your host, Kirk Keller. Our guest this morning is from Pioneer Guns and Ammo. George, good morning.
Good morning.
How are you, sir?
I'm doing great. How are you?
Cannot complain. How's business?
Business has been steady.
Fantastic.
Yes.
I would say business is probably great for you in this town because our sheriff does support the whole idea of, you know, go ahead and protect yourself if you need to.
Absolutely. Yeah, we're really lucky.
So business is good, not just on the male spectrum, but I just read an article also about females are the biggest buyers of guns this day and time.
Yes, sir. We've seen an uptick in female gun buyers and a bigger uptick in females wanting to learn how to carry, handle, discharge, and a firearm and use it for self-defense.
Well, that is one reason why I wanted you to come in today. A year ago, July, a bill passed, House Bill 543, saying that we could be permitless, and the world went crazy here in Florida. Can you kind of go back in history and tell us why they went so nuts?
Sure, absolutely. Well, it was dubbed constitutional carry. It wasn't really 100% constitutional carry because that would mean not only the concealed carry but also the exposed carry of a firearm, and that wasn't the case. The bill, what it specifically addressed was the not needing a concealed weapons license to carry a firearm concealed while you are in the state of Florida, providing you are over the age of 21 or 21 years of age or older, are a U.S. citizen or a permanent resident alien.
So one of the big myths when that was first proposed, hadn't passed yet, but when it's first proposed is that no more background checks. Is that true?
That's absolutely not true. Anyone who purchases a firearm through a federally licensed firearms dealer must complete a background check.
So kind of tell me the process of a background check. What do they look for? What's a red flag for the state of Florida to say, nope, you're not getting a gun today?
Well, everyone who buys a gun is run through the Florida Department of Law Enforcement's National Instant Criminal Background Check System. Federally licensed firearms dealers.
When you say national, that means it checks everything in all 50 states.
Yes, everything in all 50 states, and which every federally licensed firearms dealer has access to this, and it's a requirement for their licensure. Okay. And whenever we have someone that comes, let's say, to the store to purchase a firearm, they must produce a valid Florida identification card or driver's license with a current valid address. It must be, again, valid. And the person divulges their information onto this form. We use that information on the form, and we enter it into the FDLE computer. And the FDLE gives us a unique approval or non-approval or decision pending number. We utilize that in order to be able to transfer the firearm to the person after the 3-day wait, or if the person has a valid Florida concealed weapons license, they can take the firearm and forego the 3-day wait.
Is that right? I did not know that.
Yes, sir.
That is fantastic. Another myth that they had is that the concealed weapon license was going to go away altogether.
Well, that was a myth. I really wasn't sure how that was working, but I have spoken to someone at the Division of Licensing for the Department of Agriculture 6-7 months ago, and they informed me that that's not in their plans. The Florida concealed weapon license serves two purposes. Number one is to forego the 3-day wait. If the person has a concealed weapon license, like I said earlier, background check, and they can take the firearm if they're purchasing one right there at the store. The second reason to have a concealed weapon license is that it activates reciprocity with about 37 other states in the United States that have active reciprocity with the state
and
of Florida.
And you give those classes, right?
Yes, we give the Florida concealed weapon license class at our store.
How does that class work? Is it a 2-day class, 3-day class, 1-day class?
It's typically a few hours when we address use of force, how to interact with law enforcement, places where you can and can't go, the operation of a firearm, nomenclature of a firearm, nomenclature of ammunition. We deal with any questions that are in the class, and the student must discharge a firearm in the presence of the instructor. And that's per Florida State Statute 790-06, which specifically states that. The student is then given a certificate, and with that certificate, they go to the tax collector's office, have their fingerprints and photograph captured after they fill out an application, and they're issued the license.
I do think that's a very good topic of how to interact with an officer if you're, like, stopped. And the reason I say that, I think I told you this once before, my dad was a state trooper with the Missouri State Highway Patrol. I was a part-time DJ at a radio station in Carthage, Missouri. I got a part-time job after I turned 18 with Smith's Gun and Weapons. And they sold a lot of guns in the state of Missouri and in Illinois. And I wasn't really a salesman, but that's what they tagged me. But I would transport guns across state lines. And I had a trunk load of guns one time. And one of the guns I had was a Smith & Wesson 645. I don't know if you're familiar with that
yes.
or not. It's a great gun.
It is.
Anyway, I had two or three of those in the trunk of my car. They were brand new. And being a trooper's son, I have a heavy foot. And I got stopped like at 2 o'clock in the morning because, you know, that's what we do is we travel early in the morning. And they did give me a training class as, you know, roll down your window, put your hands outside, let them know that you're carrying, pop the trunk if you had a popper, and let them know you had weapons in the car. And immediately here comes another car until I had a chance to give them my permit and my ID showing who I was and why I was transporting weapons. So it is very wise that you get that training because a lot of people don't know that.
Yeah, absolutely. We make sure, at least I make sure as the instructor, that the students leave there with knowledge on how to interact with the police, not only during the course of a traffic stop, during the course of a consensual encounter, or like the police come to your house for whatever reason. We also teach the students how to interact with law enforcement in the event that they are involved in any kind of a use of force incident, which is also very important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of the people that take that class and they get that card, do they think that might be a get-out-of-jail-free card of some kind? They get a little arrogance, I guess, is the word I'm looking for?
I think at the beginning it was like that. In 1987, when the Florida concealed weapon license first came to fruition in Florida, I think it was like that. The persons before that, only the county sheriffs would issue concealed weapon licenses. And to have it, you had to be a special person or someone connected to the sheriff or somebody that the sheriff could vouch for and say, well, I know him. I'll sign a permit for him. And they were only valid in the county. To do away with that, the state legislature, created the Florida concealed weapon or firearms license. And those county licenses became, you know, they phased them out at some point.
You said business has been really good. The percentage of people that are buying a gun for the first time, what's the percentage of people that are taking that class?
A good 50%. We also have a lot of persons who are coming from out of state and moving to our area. And they like to take the class. Some of them want to take the class for knowledge, and some of them want to take the class to actually apply for the license.
Yeah, because a lot of those people are coming here, probably have guns, and don't know if they can bring it across state lines, which was one of my questions I had. What are the rules for taking, like, we're so close to Georgia. If I travel up, like my wife and I go up to a cabin up there every once in a while, if I put a gun in my car, can I take that across state lines without having to notify somebody?
Yes, absolutely. So Florida has active reciprocity with the state of Georgia, Alabama, Louisiana, Mississippi, South Carolina, all those states. You have reciprocity. If you have a Florida concealed weapons license, you can carry a firearm in those states, providing that you are a Florida resident.
But if I don't have the concealed weapons license, I can't?
If you do not have a concealed weapons license, some of those states, and you'd have to read the rules and the laws of those states, have true constitutional carry, which means providing that you are a U.S. citizen or a permanent resident alien, you can carry a firearm without a license. And if you're unsure, I always tell my students this, like especially the ones that drive from here to like New York, let's say. If they're carrying a firearm and they're not sure what the laws are of that state, unload the firearm, make it inert by putting a gun lock through it or putting it inside of a container with some gun locks. Put it in the trunk of your car, stored separately from ammunition. As you traverse or stop or your final destination is one of those non-reciprocity states.
So that was another question you brought it up is, where's the best place to carry your gun? Like I had mine in the trunk of the car. Is that the best place to keep it? Not the easiest way to get to it if you're carrying it for, you know,
right.
protection.
Right.
But if you're carrying a gun in a vehicle, where's the best place to keep it?
So as you said, if you're carrying it for self-defense, you want to have it someplace where it's within manual possession, which means you can open the glove box, reach over, and have it in your hand, or reach down into your center compartment and have it in your hand. Some people carry it inside of a bag, a purse, a briefcase, on their person, inside of a fanny pack, on their ankle, in their pocket, on their waist. any of those locations, providing that as the driver, you can reach for it and actually handle it to defend yourself or address any kind of a situation, that would be the most appropriate spot.
Where does law enforcement prefer that we carry these guns?
I don't particularly think that law enforcement has an opinion. Now, Florida is not a shall-inform state, which means you don't have to tell the police that you're carrying a firearm unless they ask. Right. So if you are stopped by the police, and most times law enforcement will ask you, hey, you have any weapons or firearms in the vehicle? Right. That would be the most appropriate time to inform law enforcement, oh, yeah, I have a firearm in the glove compartment. It depends on the officer. It depends on the situation. Some officers, you know, however the pendulum swings, some officers will say, hey, don't reach for your gun. I won't reach for my gun. Right. And some officers will say, hey, let me take the firearm. We'll give it back to you as soon as the traffic stop's over. And what's going on behind the scenes that the driver may not know is that the officer's probably running the person, make sure they're not a convicted felon, and also making sure that the firearm is not stolen. Providing those both of those are true, the driver can go on their way.
After myself, if I was an officer, I think I'd appreciate it if somebody just came out and said, officer, I just want to let you know I am carrying a vehicle and I do have my concealed weapon license with me.
Yes, and that would be my suggestion, which is part of how we treat the concealed weapon class. We always tell them, hey, you don't have to do this, but you should, for the purposes of de-escalating any kind of a concern, dispel any kind of alarm that the officer may have upon interacting with you.
So one of the other myths was that you can carry a firearm after this bill passed, 543 passed, that you'll be able to carry your gun anywhere, the grocery store, to the park, to the ball field, to the beach. Is that true?
Yes. Any location that is not prohibited by statute, you're allowed to carry. It goes a little bit further, and this is just the law. You shouldn't carry inside of locations that have a no gun sign, because if it's a private business not covered by statute, the proprietor of that business has the right to limit access to persons carrying firearms within that establishment. So they can basically say, hey, if you're carrying a gun, you can't come into the business unless you're disarmed.
The list that I looked at, there was like 35 different locations that were in that statute. One is the police station, one is the courthouse, city hall, places like that. Those are automatically covered in the statute.
Yes.
Where you cannot carry a gun at all. I did not know that. Because I see those signs all the time in different restaurants, mostly, and stores that said firearms are not permitted in the building. I didn't realize that was backed up by the state of Florida.
Well, it's not. It depends on where it is. If you have a dollar store, and the dollar store has a no gun sign, it's not covered by statute. But what is covered by statute is trespassing. If you are on the property and you inside of that particular store carrying a firearm and it is discovered by whatever means, you reached up to grab a can of beans and someone saw it under your shirt, they contact law enforcement, doesn't necessarily mean that you'll be arrested because it's not a statutory violation, but it can mean that you can be trespassed and said, law enforcement can say, hey, the owners don't want you here with a firearm, please leave.
Even if you have a concealed license?
Even if you have a concealed, it's proprietor's rights.
That's true. I did not know that.
Yes.
I've got a lot more questions for you, George, when we come back from this commercial break. I'm going to go for it, okay?
Yes, sir.
This is the Business Report. We'll be right back right after this.
Free for All Friday.
You're looking at the cost of housing. Now you can just knock $21,000 right there in the city of Palm Coast. That's going to impact fees.
Local voices.
We're not just polishing what we have. We also have to begin preparing for what the future generations will want.
I'm David Ayers. Join me and my co-host, Brian McMillan. Free for All Friday, following the news at 9 and Pierre's Reality Check. Right here on WNZF with streaming and podcasts on the Flagler Radio mobile app.
Good morning and welcome back to the Business Report. I'm your host, Kirk Keller. My guest this morning is George with Pioneer Guns and Ammo, and we're talking about House Bill 543, which passed last year in July, and there was a bunch of protests about this bill. Did you get involved in any of the protests? Did you have some problems at your store during these protests?
Absolutely not. There were expected protests on behalf of the anti-gunners, But we really didn't see much of it. And those rumors of, oh, the world, Florida's going crazy, we're going to have shootouts in the parking lot, none of that came to fruition. It was all – I believe the majority of gun owners and a vast high percentage of that majority are good, law-abiding people. I see them every day at the store. They come. They want to learn. Some of them know the law very well, and some of them are thirsty for knowledge. And when they come and they learn from us either in our class or during a, you know, over-the-counter conversation, they leave with good information that provides them with enough ammunition, pun intended, to stay on the right side of the law.
Right. You gave a much better description than I did, but basically what Bill 543 states is you do not have to have a concealed permit anymore to carry a gun.
That is correct.
You went into a little bit more depth earlier in the show. And that's what was freaking people out. They thought the criminals were going to flock to Florida and have guns. I have not seen that happen. Have you?
Well, I can no, I haven't. Not with a great percentage that is trackable.
Right.
But what I can tell you is this, at least not in our area, in our jurisdiction here, if you are a felon carrying a firearm, you can not only bet, but you can guarantee that if you're intercepted by law enforcement, that you will go to jail.
Especially here in Flagler County.
Absolutely.
We have to
100%.
We have to pat Sheriff Staley on the back every time we get a chance because our crime is down. I read articles of what happens in Volusia County. I read articles of what's happening up in St. John's County. And Flagler County is like this bubble of the dome. Remember the TV show The Dome?
Of course. We have
like this dome that protects us, but he's done a great job. His deputies have done a great job protecting us.
The greatest ally we have here in the county for gun rights, gun right activism, and citizens being able to defend themselves is Sheriff Staley. 100%.
Another myth was that with this new law, 543, passed, that we're going to see an increase in school shootings. I don't think we've had a school shooting since.
No, sir. I haven't seen anything, again, trackable. I checked some of the FBI statistics before we came on the show. Nothing like that. Some of the Florida State UCRs, which are the uniform crime reports, there, nothing like that has come up. There hasn't been an increase in firearms violence directly related to non-licensed individuals.
And what I found in my research is every school shooting we've had here in Florida, they were licensed and they were legal guns. They weren't illegal guns.
Yep.
And I don't think a criminal is going to go out and get a legal gun. Well, you know, most of them are illegal guns.
Oh, absolutely.
Somehow, some way, they're buying guns off the streets.
Around here, and what I've read, what you can read in the news, is some of the criminals that traverse through Flagler County and are intercepted by the law enforcement here are persons who, you know, come here to commit crimes, and then they're caught, and then they happen to be either felon or in possession of narcotics, the possession of firearms, and then law enforcement leans on them pretty good. Those are the persons that we want to stay out, and it's because of those persons who victimize the citizens of our county that our citizens want to remain armed.
Why do you think this Bill 543 was introduced and passed?
I believe it was only a matter of time. 27 or 29 other states already have constitutional or permitless carry. And I think that Florida wanted to fall in line with the rest of the state. I think that there's a nationwide movement on nationwide carry, either permitless or if there is a national permitting system that one day may come to life, that becomes possible. So persons who are law-abiding citizens can carry firearms in any location, except those prohibited ones, of course, courthouse, jails, sheriff's offices, with a national license or maybe no license. You know, the Second Amendment is very simple, but it's also pretty broad. Mm-hmm. And it does give the citizenry the benefit of carrying a firearm or possessing a firearm for self-defense.
Do you think if the bad guys or the scumbags or dirtbags, I guess is what the different sheriffs have called around, do the dirtbags, if they know that we might have a gun on us, there's less chances of being mugged or robbed?
Well, if I were a criminal, I would. Because, you know, somebody that I'm at, as if I were a criminal and I were to target someone for any kind of a violent crime or just a petty crime, and I know that they're armed, I'd probably say, I don't want to mess with that person.
Right. So have we seen a decrease in the state of Florida crime that you know of?
Well, I can tell you that from what I've read here and
I know Flagler County
is doing very, very well. And in the state of Florida, if I'm not mistaken, I think Governor DeSantis also said that crime is down at a significant point, a significant percentage in the state of Florida.
Well, I know the state troopers here are just absolutely fantastic, and you know that could be one reason, but DeSantis has been a fantastic governor for us.
Yes, he has.
George, let's talk about you a little bit. Tell us your background. How did you get involved in selling guns?
Well, it's a family business. My father opened Pioneer Guns in 1969.
I did not know that.
Yes, and he had a security guard company for many, many years, over 45 years, and the gun shop was attached to it, and he had that mainly for the purposes of police equipment and selling firearms to armed guards or armored guard transports, et cetera. But he also was open to the public and doing gun shows for many, many years. And then, you know, during my lifetime, I became a law enforcement officer. I'm still a law enforcement officer. And it's been something that's always been – it's being a family business. It's
near
always
and
been
dear to your heart, right?
It's very near and dear to my heart. I'm an ardent supporter of the Second Amendment. I'm a life member of the NRA. I'm an NRA police firearms instructor. I'm a FDLE police firearms instructor. I also teach at the police academy. I've been doing that for many years as well.
So you're the go-to guy.
Well, for firearms, I was a subject matter expert many years, 20 years ago for FDLE when they changed their curriculum to the new, well, now it's the old, but it was the new back then, qualification standard for law enforcement. They used to call it the CMS. I was one of the subject matter experts for that, helped that get going, and trained most of South Florida's instructors on becoming instructors for the new curriculum. So, yeah, it's been something that that I have near and dear to my heart. And if I can help anyone, all they got to do is come by the store and see me there.
Would you promote gun safety in schools?
Of course. Why not? When I was very young, in the late 70s, early 80s, elementary school, they had a visitation from the Eddie Eagle program from the NRA. And it was a brief inside of the auditorium, and it was basically flyers that they would hand out and talk about gun safety and children shouldn't touch guns and inform an adult. And then also parents were invited to these Eddie Eagle programs and given other flyers and say how to teach your kids about gun safety at home. When you take them shooting, show them, you know, not to point the firearm at someone, know what their target is and what is beyond, keep their finger out of the trigger unless they're ready to fire. All of the safety aspects that we teach, that we hold near and dear today to teach just basic firearm safety. I'm 100% a proponent of if we could do that, if we would allow at the very minimum. Yeah, we used to. If at the very minimum, if there was something cut out in the curriculum that would say, hey, let's deal with the very real aspect of firearms. It's part of our country. It's part of what we are as citizens. And teach children, hey, keep away from firearms. And if you ever do, find yourself in a situation where you find a firearm, notify an adult. And also take whatever safety classes you should with your parents.
I grew up in a very rural area, Carthage, Missouri, town of 12,000. We carried guns in our car. At deer season, we'd have a rifle in the back seat, or if you had a truck, it'd be on the rifle rack. I mean, we just grew up around guns. We'd go skeet shooting in school. We had skeet shooting classes in school where we'd go out and shoot shotguns.
Awesome.
So I just think we've gotten away from that from whatever reason. And that might, because we didn't have school shootings back then, nothing at all like we have had in recent years.
Oh, yeah, I know. I think also another reason for that is that we've had a big influx of people from out of state. And the persons who come from out of state bring their reasoning or their angle to the state of Florida. And sometimes those persons become elected officials, and sometimes those persons become school board superintendents or commissioners or whatnot. And they stimulate the changing of the law or create a law that restricts gun safety.
Well, I'm glad the bill passed. Like you said, we haven't seen crime increase. It's not been a threat. It's been a good thing. Because I do think if criminals think you might be carrying a gun, they're not going to rob you, mug you, whatever the word is this day. So I think this is a great bill. Before we go, tell us more about Pioneer Guns. How do we get in touch with you? Where's the store at?
Oh, yeah. And before I go into that, let me just say, for those persons who do carry a firearm on a daily basis or have guns at home or anytime you have a firearm close to you for the purposes of self-defense, have a plan. Know who you're going to call. Practice, practice, practice. Interact with your family and let them know what they need to do in the event that you are involved in a use of force incident, whether it's call your attorney, call the police, provide the police with whatever information that they need, but make sure that you have a plan. That's the most important.
I'm glad you brought that up. Is it wise to take a refresher class?
Yeah, because sometimes laws change. And another thing that I see, sometimes like we get veterans, and the veterans with their DD-214, they don't need to take a class. However, sometimes their understanding, what I have experienced, is that sometimes the understanding that they bring to like the state of Florida, if they're from out of state, is a little skewed, is a little different from what Florida advises. So, yes, I always think that anyone who is either not originally from the state or just a recent person who just moved here should take a refresher class.
Excellent. All right. Now, tell us what the store is.
Oh, we're at 4490 North Highway US 1. It's a big pink Alamo shopping center. Can't miss it. We got a big red flag. It reads Guns Open, Pioneer Guns. We have a great selection. We just started carrying a line of safes. So we have security safes, all sizes. We have furniture-looking safes. We have in-the-wall safes. We have standalone safes. And it's a really, really nice line that we just brought up. And I was informed this morning that we're receiving a whole new line of, Smith & Wesson and Canic firearms from the distributor that aren't necessarily out yet. So we're getting a lot of new stuff, and just come by. We have ammo, we have shooting supply, we have optics, we have some pre-owned guns, and some customers like the pre-owned guns.
I got one question, and we got like 30 seconds. Glock, are they ceramic?
No, they're not ceramic. They're polymer and steel.
Okay. That was the question we had yesterday, that ceramic guns are Glocks. But anyway, thank you very much. Pioneer Guns, George, been on the show today. This is the Business Report. See you next Saturday.